Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here and an honor to be at the launch of this initiative. And I hope that after the framing, the general framing of the previous speakers, you are, as I am, with more questions and some strong disagreements and also wondering how a small initiative in a city can reverse this monster that we are creating. To jump straight into the debate and the questions, I would like to ask Francesco, because there's many people online and many people here wondering what's this bits about. Is it a utopia, or do you think that what is the magic solution that you have engineered to save us from this really sad situation we are in?
Thanks, Renata. So I guess with this first question you're making, my position, I was already feeling pretty uncomfortable after the first session to be in this position of being representing a city and the rebel city and a politician. And usually when politicians come on this type of event and they ask to deliver outcomes, as Evgeny was saying, we always say we have solutions to all the problems and, you know, project this wonderful magic, picture of what we're going to do and project also confidence that everything is under control and we actually know exactly what needs to be done. So not only I was feeling pretty uncomfortable before to hear about exactly that kind of elite populism that brings cities at the core of, okay, you need to solve everything and you need to deliver on all these big problems. And I was reflecting a lot about that, thinking, okay, there certainly are things that not only we are prepared to do, but we are doing in Barcelona. And we are doing them thanks to the fact that actually the current government is a pretty atypical government that is in power because of a radical democratic movement. So all the time we remind ourselves, actually, I'm not a professional politician. I come from civil society. I'm a citizen. And, you know, I'm here as part of, you know, we are the citizens. And now we are in the institutions and we are finding a way to make the institutions fit better with society, meaning really bringing in the core of public administration a radical democratic agenda. And when you do that, not always you find yourself in a position to deliver more efficient and smoother solution, just because you find that there is a very contradicting agenda, which is the public sector agenda, that conflicts very much with the citizens' one. And so, you know, most of the time, we kind of find ourselves fighting inside the machine, if you wish, or fighting within a system that doesn't seem designed to put into practice some of the key programmatic elements that I've been hearing from Evgeny and from Paul. And I think that's the first thing that we are struggling with, you know, the public sector and the kind of institutional taking from a democratic citizen movement of the public institution and finding yourself with a machine that's not designed to maximize the public good, the common good, and to build this utopia, right? And I mean, I think I feel I'm pretty comfortable to reject this kind of pressure at a global level that the urban agenda, meaning that cities have to find the solution for everything. I mean, when Gerardo at the very beginning was talking about a radical network of rebel cities, I feel like we should expand that, you know, not only a radical network of rebel cities, but also, you know, opening up to social movements, to alternative type of, you know, cooperatives, enterprises, companies, and at a higher level to government, progressive governments all around the world and supranational organizations that are tackling these issues, right? It doesn't feel good enough to do it just at the city level, really. Although I think we are on our way to do like very, very exciting things here in Barcelona, due to the fact that we are here as part of this bigger movement. And regarding two beats, you know, for us, as Gerardo was saying at the very beginning, when you do your kind of day-to-day policy, you have little time for bigger reflections. And you're pressed to take this kind of, to show citizens and to show, you know, to show citizens that we have practical solutions that will affect their life on a short term. And this is our task there. I mean, to have a short term, a medium term, a longer term program, but really to show that we're able to do things that change people's life. So, you know, you do not have enough moments like this one where you can reflect on the kind of micro level type of problems. You can analyze how technology at the intersection with cities, financialization and democracy are really playing out, and you can, and so we need this kind of moments, and we need bits at the intersection with the global network movement of thinkers, social movements and political progressive people that can bring this, and I mean, we're very, very happy to host it in Barcelona. So to me, what I see here that has been proposed by BITS goes very much beyond Barcelona. We are very happy that this is happening here, and to host it, that the Barcelona can become the reference for a post-capitalist, technology-driven program. But, you know, it is a global agenda, and it feels that way.
So basically you're trying to test locally something that can scale, broader scale and outreach. But I'm worried about something, and it is in the lines of what Evgeny said and what Paul said, that we, like the space to operate and the space to implement this is shrinking rapidly, and democracy, as we have seen, is not getting stronger, it's not getting is not favoring people anymore. So we have a system of global trade that really restricts what a city can do. I mean, there's this, you cannot reverse contracts that have been signed. You cannot reverse, it's really hard to reverse rules that are in place. It's really hard to find funds when the public administrations are defunded. On the other hand, you have their fraud, as Evgeny explained, that delivers, and that delivers and gets very public about their success and their delivery. This all, basically, Silicon Valley is moving fast to control media and to control the news that are feeding to our brains. So, and on top of that, we have the capture of academia. We have most of the universities and most of the experts funded by this system. So I want to hear from Paul and Evgeny. Like the bigger picture of the problem and how how these bits can help a bit
solving solutions. We have to very analog move things around. So one of the things I have really tried to do with my work, having been an activist in the British labour movement all my life, is to give all of us a positive project. Because I think that, especially in the period of so-called one no and many yeses of the anti-globalization movement, we all got used to not having an overarching goal. And I think in the post-capitalism book and in my work, I've tried to say, you know, the goal, the old goal is not the goal. The goal of a planned economy based on scarcity is the wrong goal. There is an objective we can fight for, no matter how distant it seems, because it has validity in the observation of the present reality. This in itself is a strong counterpower to what Evgeny describes. Because it's not based on, it's actually not based on utopian thinking. It's based on the practice of ordinary people. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, I do not, although I completely agree with your description of reality and what you've just said, Renata, in terms of the strength of what they are throwing at us, I don't see it as a stable system. In other words, I don't, you know, the entire thing is kept alive by central banks. The entire thing is leading to stagnation on a global scale. They themselves, the powerful, the G20, are terrified. They're terrified of the power of the masses, and they're also terrified of the stagnation of what they have created. And because of this, I think it is possible to start a conversation. No, I don't think we're going to have much of a conversation with Uber, but I think you could probably have a conversation with the big technology companies about, okay, what is the difference between what we want and what you want, capable of producing a negotiated space where some of us get what we want for a time? I don't think you know, if I could be king of Barcelona for one day, I wouldn't start by cancelling all the contracts of everybody. I would pick one, and I would work on it. I would work on a renegotiation. Because actually, what these cities, which simply want technological sovereignty, are doing is only what businesses had to do in the earlier period when monopolistic technology companies attacked their right to be sovereign as businesses. You know, I covered computing in the 1990s. Every story was the same story. The same story over and over again. What it says on the box does not work. You have been sold it for multi-millions. In the meantime, not only is it not working, they have captured all your data. They know your business better than you know your business. And the first job of the CTO is to regain control over the operations of the business, expelling the predatory monopolist provider. This is an old story. Every big business understands it. And I think the cities to be in the game of doing this can learn a lot from the way businesses have recaptured sovereignty over their own decision making. But of course, the city is only the intermediary between, you know, the large technology provider and the citizen, and that's the challenge, to empower the citizen in that process and to make them understand. I mean, as Yevgeny, I think, has very, very articulately explained what it is that you are doing, you know, when your credit card is deducted for a ride on Uber, or a stay in an Airbnb. You are doing many things, and I think the citizen. Well, one thing we can do is to simply make transparent to the citizen whose profit stream they are fueling and what the alternatives could be. The actual amazing thing about modern capitalism is that its relentless message is there is no alternative. You know, this thing that didn't exist 5 years ago, there's now no alternative to it. It is the natural state of the world, that all minicab systems in the entire world must be destroyed by this one company that didn't exist 10 years ago. We can give people an alternative, a choice.
I sí que hi ha alternatives. Hi hem de donar opcions.
Now we are running into limits. Technological sovereignty. Which one? This one. Does it work?
No.
Maybe
you get closer.
All right. Wow. You see, technology is bringing us closer.
La tecnologia ens acosta. Ara aquest tampoc funciona I aquest tampoc.
Well, okay, it's working now. So I agree with Paul, actually, on the inherent instability of the system. I mean, we all know that it's not just through central banks that the system is propped up in the U.S. and increasingly in Europe. It's also through, you know, what some sociologists would call prison fare. That the system operates is basically by locking up quite a lot of young unemployed and mostly black people. And here, you know, we're talking about refugees and immigrants probably in Europe, because there is no other way to provide them with welfare. So prison fare becomes the alternative model to actually generating some kind of stability in the system. So it's an extremely violent system that, despite all its pretensions to some kind of personal empowerment, does exercise a lot of violence. And I would argue that it's only going to get worse with pervasive surveillance and here into the smart city, with drones flying around our heads, and with all sorts of new methods and mechanisms of policing. That said, I think we have to understand that the system itself has been extremely inventive and creative. I mean, if you look at mainstream economic and sociological analysis of where most advanced economies are right now, you know, if you take somebody like Wolfgang Strick, for example, one of the most talented German economic sociologists, you know, his argument has been that system has more or less been buying time through debt, right? It was public debt, private debt, again, public debt, and it's through debt that the system has more or less survived, and now we're running into the limits of the system, right? And to some extent, this is true, but that analysis in itself does not incorporate this heavily influential and important role that is now increasingly being delegated to Silicon Valley and technology firms in terms of creating some kind of entrepreneurial welfare, with some of us becoming the precarious entrepreneurs and earning some money through Airbnb and Uber on the one hand, and enjoying cheaper prices because these firms have captured all of the infrastructure, right? So there are other ways of buying time that we are aware of, right? And technology is generating them. Technology is actually generating them, so we have to keep that in mind. But I think the main way through which this instability of the system is being kept at bay and is being controlled is also through intellectual hegemony, right? And intellectual hegemony, you know, as we all know from Gramsci, it's not something that just is exercised naturally and effortlessly, right? It requires a lot of effort and it requires a lot of work, right? It requires a lot of also intellectual work on behalf of the elites and on behalf of holders of capital in order to more or less justify their rule and to convince us that there is actual progress, innovation, and so forth. And I would argue that the language of technology and the language of Silicon Valley, if you will, are increasingly important and fundamental to the exercise of this neoliberal hegemony, partly by taking on and incorporating this language and incorporating its categories, vocabulary, and the basic worldview. We are also internalizing many of their truths. And I would argue that what we need is a thorough cleansing of our own vocabulary that has more or less been developed in the 1990s following the birth of the internet as an object of analysis inside mostly American law schools. Why on earth should social movements in Barcelona be constrained by the vocabulary developed by a bunch of lawyers in Harvard or Stanford, who themselves claim to be apolitical and objective, while all of them have studied with Richard Posner in Chicago and more or less have a very distinguished neoliberal pedigree, even though they claim that what they're studying is cyber law and not some kind of neoliberal law and economics practice. Right? I mean, there are a whole set of ideas that have come to dominate how we think and understand the world that I think have to be completely thrown away. I mean, at this point, the problem in the tech sector is almost as bad as that in economics, I mean, and finance, where again, the vocabulary has also become completely outdated. If you look at some of the recent articles in The Intercept, a very interesting online publication, they have basically identified that virtually all of the funding that major privacy researchers get at this point to study privacy comes from Google. I mean, and Google is not a company that we traditionally think of as Goldman Sachs or JP Morgan that is there to influence how we think about privacy or technology. But we also have to recognize that at this point, Google spends more on lobbying than Goldman Sachs. Right? But it's not just this obvious corporate efforts that we need to understand. It's also smaller efforts. I mean, we have to understand what is the open government agenda? Why is the U.S. government so much behind it? Why is the Department of State of the United States is pushing for blockchain-based technologies around the globe? We have to be able to understand how this seemingly innocent technological ideas actually embed certain ideological visions of the world, you know, and those visions of the world are, you know, transparency by default, and we all love transparency, but in this context, its use is primarily at monitoring what the public sector does, shrinking it, and arguing that the solutions offered by the solutions economy, quote-unquote, of the private sector are far more effective. Right? And we have to understand that there are certain ideological projects that the language of technology has completely depoliticized. And it is the task of cities like Barcelona to be able to repoliticize these domains. And I'm not just talking about ownership of data, I'm not just talking about the question of smart cities, I'm not just talking about the Internet of Things. The basic categories that we use, which have completely kind of excluded considerations of property ownership, ownership systems, you know, why are we just talking about privacy? Right, for example, in this debate. Privacy is something that can be delivered by the market. You can go and buy yourself some privacy if you're willing to spend 500 euros on buying yourself a secure phone and all sorts of apps that will guard you. We do not want privacy, right, delivered as a service. We want a right to privacy, right, which is very different. But this ability to be able to ask these political questions, not just about the end goals of what we want of technology policy, but also about the mechanisms and the means of delivering them, whether we delegate that to the market, or whether we do it through the delegation and creation of socioeconomic rights, it's a very big question. And we should not let Silicon Valley and technology sector in general, which themselves, again, are not acting independently. I mean, they are deeply embedded with all sorts of political and geopolitical institutions. We should not let them answer those questions by default, just because we are too busy to actually react and formulate an alternative vocabulary and an alternative agenda.
Okay, great. So to go back to Francesca, so this BITS initiative seems, I mean, what Evgeny was describing is basically that even civil society, and even civil society that were like the pioneers in technology and decentralized options and so on, are absolutely captured, and all these youth movements around open data and so on are absolutely following and falling into the trap of the Silicon Valley dystopia. So which, how can we bring them back, and how can we regain terrain from these grassroots movements? Do you have any plans on that? And also, the same with academia, because something that I really like you to explain is this multi-layer approach that you have with BITS, and I think that people will also like.
It's not really an initiative that we carry forward. I mean, you should ask probably like my kind of like reflection also based on what I'm learning about and the movement here, the reason why you can say there is an intellectual hegemony and the technological agenda is completely captured within the neoliberal paradigm. If we want to call it that way, we can argue that we are facing something new that cannot be named like that. It's also because, radical movements like the one that are in power now in Barcelona, which have a very radical agenda when it comes to access to housing, education, health, and public space, and energy sovereignty, they haven't really tackled the question of the technological agenda or put it at the core of how you rethink access to the basics of life, how you rethink the role of the state and the role of the public sector, and how you rethink the citizen democracy within that. So that's why I think actually having this debate where put at the center technology, not in a sense of technology as the gadget, but in a sense of the question that technology is posing, which are a bigger level of ownership structure, of access to basic infrastructure, the question of the precariat, it's key in order to redefine this agenda for progressive movements. And that I think answer a little bit. I mean, clearly there is an imbalances of power where, I mean, my first question is, also have an economic background, who is funding the alternative? I mean, it is clear to me that when you start listing, you know, I mean, before Evgeny had this polemical thinking with, philanthrocapitalism and all the tech companies, and we know how much actually the tech companies themselves, like, you know, Google, Facebook, and others, are enlarging their philanthrocapitalism mission, right? I mean, I don't think that, you know, when we hear that Facebook is bringing connectivity to India, or when we hear that, Google is doing like social inclusion policies in Latin America and, you know, in Cuba right now. I mean, you know, that's a kind of humanitarian agenda that they're putting forward, which clearly isn't at the core of the business model. I mean, their business model is not to, to care for access to education, good jobs, and public services. And I think we have to be very clear when we talk about the fraud that actually they will never deliver good jobs and access to public services and cheap public services and the welfare state to the precariat. They won't be doing that. And also they won't be delivering cheap housing to the population. I mean, this is not their business. And you know, so we know this is happening. Clearly it's much less clear to understand who is gonna fund this alternative. And by fund, I don't only mean, you know, I mean, I do mean also funding as in terms of, you know, long-term innovation funding that can get out of this, economy the way it's stagnating today. I mean, if we think about funding infrastructure, which are the core of the future economy, and funding green, you know, green economy, and creating jobs that are not bullshit jobs, I mean, this is not something that it just happens. I mean, it requires a big effort of thinking about new economic models, thinking about the long-term investments, thinking about, you know, an alternative to the financial casino, right? So it's posing as a problem. I wanna reflect a little bit on the positive agenda, because I do think that, you know, while the problems are big and complex, and of course not, it's not possible to deal with them on a kind of short-term and city level only, I think we can do a lot of things. And at the very beginning, for instance, Maya was talking about something that, you know, pertains to corruption. Right, institutional corruption. I mean, it is true that, for instance, in my role now, looking at technology policy of a city from a city perspective, the first thing, you know, I had to do was actually investigating corruptive practices. Because, you know, because when you say there are big contracts that get done in a way that is not transparent to the citizens, meaning the citizens don't know what we're buying with their money, this is most of the time, you know, corruption practices. And you know, so for instance, just starting from La Puerta Giratoria or, you know, this kind of malpractices that you see happening where, you know, you can exactly see, I work with a provider and that provider has a politician that before was working for that corporation and they're all my friends and that's how we spend public money. Clearly that cannot be done. And so, you know, we are at the process of implementing, I mean, not only transparency when it comes to the providers we work with, I mean, we have been putting the budget of the city hall, the entire one, and also the technology one online. And I mean, yes, it's true, transparency is not a panacea, but when we start doing transparency for power and not just transparency for the citizens, meaning surveillance, we are reverting that process. And, you know, another very clear example is shifting to free software or open source software. Also that, I mean, it seems, first of all, it's something very difficult to do because we have legacy systems that we have lock-ins, we have like lots of difficulties. But clearly the intention to shift your services and the way you procure and buy technology to be ethical, to work with open systems, to avoid the lock-in, to engage the providers that are out there and maybe in this room that develop free software and open technology to work with the city, it's a big step, and we're determined to do that. Let me go into the data. The question of data ownership, that's another thing that's very interesting for cities, because, I mean, of course, when we talk about data infrastructure of a city, I mean, first of all, I think it's a big step to intend, like, understand data as an infrastructure, meaning as we're thinking about gas, energy, water, public transportation, we we also think about data. And it's fundamental then, you know, to have access and to control this data in a way that it can become a public good and in a way that it can be governed with ethics at the core. And ethics at the core means going beyond privacy. I mean, means like embedding the new citizens' rights in the way we design and build technology. Because, you know, citizens are not aware. I mean, yes, it's true, there is a lot of debate about that, you know, data is the oil of the 21st century, about all the businesses that run on our data. We do not know how this happened in a simple way. We're not transparent about it, and the public sector is not doing that. And I think it's a duty for us to say no to surveillance capitalism, find alternatives. I do not also think that the future of the economy can be funded by advertising-fueled surveillance models that sells people's behavior. I do not think that this is an economic model that is going to lead us to this long-term innovation that we need. And I mean, I want to say like one more thing about promoting alternatives. Because it has been said, you can do a lot to promote alternatives. When I came to Barcelona, I became very impressed about what we have in the city. I was also before. I mean, I did a report for the European Commission on digital social innovation, meaning alternative platform cooperatives, open hardware, free software, social impact technology, a few years ago, and some of the key experiments were Catalan, and I highlighted them, and they were, you know, they were very visible. And when I came here, it was very clear, for instance, in one of the most technologically advanced neighborhoods of the city, which is Arroba 22, that is famous because we test products with big companies. Actually, what I was very, very interested and super surprised, it's the network of makerspaces, fab labs, atelier, co-working, you know, local food production that have a different economic model in mind, that is sustainable, that is different, that is local, that is territorial. For the city. So the proposal is we cannot give 100% only to the big tech companies and to fuel that model. We can give 50-50, right? Something like that.
It seems Barcelona like a fertile soil to plant the seed and maybe spread it around. But before continuing, and because we have very little time now, we will open the floor for 5 questions. And we asked first the first 2 questions, then they answered, then the last 3 questions, and then they answer, and then we end the session. So anyone has any questions for Francesca, Evgenia, and Paul?
For Francesca, Evgenia, and Paul.
Okay. Yeah. Yes? Okay. Yes, please.
Yeah, I'm finishing up. I came to Barcelona to finish up a project.
And vaig a venir a Barcelona per acabar un projecte
to digitize and make available newspapers produced by anti-war soldiers in the Vietnam War.
Un projecte d'un diari que feien els soldats que havien estat a la guerra de Vietnam.
Practice was that the people who produced the newspapers should get them for free, and therefore it shouldn't be a...
S'havia d'establir una xarxa.
How much do you see the transformation of...
Com veuen la transformació d'aquestes ciutats tecnològiques en una tecnologia que pugui servir les persones i només sigui el benefici? La idea de que la informació pertany a tothom. La pregunta és...
Is it possible within a technological system to take that kind of thinking and make it transnational?
Que un sistema tecnològic adopti aquest sistema de pensament i el fa converteixi en una cosa transnacional?
Another question?
Una altra pregunta?
Yes. I would suggest to explore,
diria que potser podríem estudiar, perquè s'ha esmentat en algun moment, explorar més la possibilitat d'explotar models híbrids, on hi ha models que són similars
als que Paul s'ha referit,
i models que
aims and trajectories.
It's
clear that this is happening.
Això
there are a lot of
ja
ambiguities and contradictions
I
there, but this is for sure a space of exploration,
political
és un espai
intervention,
d'intervenció
política,
d'innovació.
I és interessant parlar, veure com aquests nous models
oberts
fan servir la
competència
capitalista i veure com polítiques públiques o alternatives poden explotar aquesta competència que s'està donant en aquest món comercial. I també un altre aspecte d'ambivalència que penso que podríem explorar és el tema...
Because there is a sort of preference that I understand, of course,
de la mida,
the little,
perquè hi ha una tendència cap a iniciatives locals petites comparades amb aquestes iniciatives globals o aquests actors globals
grans.
At
the same time, I think I was reading recently an interview that Evgeny gave to New Left Tribune, and he was reflecting how is also at the same time intrinsic in some way in the productivity of this logic like networks,
aquestes xarxes
forms
tenen
of centralization,
una,
forms of
formes de centralització intrínseques.
So we have to recognize that this
per
is
tant,
also
hem
a level
de reconèixer que
we
això
have
també
to,
és una cosa
and,
que hem d'integrar
developing
i desenvolupar
way, of course, but
una alternativa alhora. La mida
challenge
és un repte
that we have to
integrate. Thank you so
well.
Much.
Tenir en compte.
Last question for this round. L'última
pregunta.
Anyone?
Anna was here.
Anna?
A different sort of topic. I just wanted to ask.
Micròfon,
sorry,
sisplau.
Just wait for the mic.
I just had a point about the
m'agradaria fer una observació sobre la renda bàsica. En Paul l'ha esmentat, que dependria de la participació. I em preguntava si l'exclusió de tantes persones ara dels béns comuns, si això pot funcionar sense una agenda més comunitària de drets socials. Comencem amb l'Evgeny. M'han dit que si continuava parlant funcionaria, no sé si continua funcionant el micròfon. Sí, funciona.
Ok, so I'll just use this one. All right, now it's very modular. All right, so I would like to have two things to say, basically. I would like to speak actually a little bit about basic income because I also find it fascinating, and I would like to talk a bit more about this ambivalence that you've heard about. So on the basic income, I think it actually illustrates very nicely my previous point about the increasing hegemony also of Silicon Valley, because if you look at who's dominating this discussion in the United States, primarily it's venture capitalists who have discovered that they all love basic income and are organizing conferences and are putting it on the agenda nationally in America, which would seem like an extremely surprising undertaking unless you actually analyze what it is that's driving them. And I don't think that it's just driven by some kind of libertarian Hayekian view of the basic income as a replacement of the welfare state, because clearly in America, welfare state has been privatized a long time ago. So if you look at provision of health care in America, I mean, yes, you have a welfare state, but it's a welfare state that operates essentially through private firms that can charge whatever they want to the government, which explains why healthcare costs so much in the United States. So it's not the abolition of the welfare state that their support of basic income implies. I think what Silicon Valley has understood is that it's not just this kind of privatized welfare that I talked about through Uber or Google or Airbnb that we are talking about when we talk about Silicon Valley. You know, I'm very guilty of that mistake because I tend to lump all these companies together and I tend to speak of Silicon Valley as if it had a common agenda, which of course it doesn't. you do have firms that are primarily interested in what I call data extractivism, right? Which is finding a model through which they can get as much data as they can, analyze it, create an artificial intelligence service, and then find a way to monetize it. But there are a lot of other firms working on the periphery, right? And what does periphery involve? Periphery involves more or less creating sensors, analytics, connectivity for systems like the ones I described when it comes to infrastructure. It's a way to basically create a road toll around everything. You want to create a way to charge the maximum amount to users of a technological system in a way that would be impossible to avoid, just like a road toll charges you the maximum once you, go through it. Right? So I think that this infrastructure of charging is also extremely important, and this is also Silicon Valley. This is the merger of sensors and connectivity that gives us this new infrastructure, essentially for charging prices and costs to assets that have been privatized and turned over to the private sector. If you accept that this is a very valid and profitable line of business, and it is, and it is even more so now that big four consulting firms are moving into it, you clearly realize that if people are not earning anything, how on earth are they supposed to be paying for all those toll roads and all the other little rents that are proliferating everywhere? I mean, it's not like everything is free, as much as I would like to agree with Paul. Information products are free. Everything else, I mean, you have to pay for. You know, Ryanair at some point considered charging users for going to the toilet, and I think that's more or less is the paradigm on which the rest of the economy that's not fully informationalized operates. It's finding ways to charge rent, which also makes me think that we are much closer to feudalism under the current model than to post-capitalism if you look at the physical economy only, which to me suggests that these firms do need a way to get people earning money so that you can actually get 50, 80, 90% of that income elsewhere by charging them rents through use of infrastructure and any other assets, right? And I think this partially explains why Silicon Valley wants to find a basic income solution, because otherwise people who have no cash and whose exposure to credit is limited have no way to pay for this other economy that operates entirely on charging, right? So this is something to keep in mind. The only last thing I want to say is about size. And kind of local global paradoxes that we see. I think that the traditional strategies of the left when it comes to cities, the strategies have revolved around remunicipalization. Social movements that came to power, and alternative political movements that came to power, wanted to remunicipalize infrastructure. The grid, water, gas, it has happened in Europe, it has happened in many cities quite successfully. In Germany, in Scandinavia, this agenda has taken place. When you look at data, right, when you look at cloud infrastructure, when you look at this kind of infrastructure, the same kind of remunicipalization strategies are very hard to pull off. You cannot go and remunicipalize Google, which promises you to basically optimize your traffic flow. Right? It's not as easy because also they do not have any physical presence in the country, and most of their gains do not happen just through individual contracts with cities. They happen through capturing the users by providing consumer services. So you are captured by Google not because your city has decided to contract with Google. You're captured by Google because you carry its mobile phone with its Gmail system, which then generates data about where you are, which is then repackaged and sold to the city. Right? And I think that this poses an immense challenge to cities, and it also tells you that if we really want to think of alternative ways of providing big data and analytical infrastructure, we need to find ways to pool efforts. As Francesca was saying, and it has to happen not just at the level of cities that oppose the neoliberal agenda, partnering with each other, it also has to involve other alternative players, whether it's companies opposed to this agenda, governments, transnational institutions, you name it. There is no other way around it, and there is nothing to municipalize when it comes to AI and cloud infrastructure. As it pains me to say, the traditional toolkit of the left and social movements does not work here.
I think that it's a boycott by the Google Maps.
Yeah. Google Maps.
Hello. Yeah. Okay. Just add a couple of things. I mean, one, I think provocatively
all the time I hear the debate on basic income. I feel actually that's one of the hybrids we can tackle, which is, you know, maybe it's not that bad at this point to partner with everyone that wants to implement this agenda, because we do actually need basic income now. And although there is a lot of difference on how basic income is being conceived, I mean, never implemented, by the way, by actually Silicon Valley, but advocated by those firms. I mean, actually, the implementation that we're seeing and we've been seeing for a long time around basic income also really poses the question of indirect income. So basic income is not just cash flow, it's indirect income, which is the welfare state that needs to be redefined according to today's economy. So, I mean, to me, that's a leftist problem, where you cannot put at the core something like the basic income when every forecast you tells you that, you know, you're going to get rid of, like, millions of jobs, even 60% of the jobs we have today, but automating key sectors of the economy. I mean, you know, like transport, logistics, like, forget about it. So we do need a basic income now, and we need to create future jobs. And future jobs also mean better life for citizens and for people, and so rethink the welfare system. It's not impossible. Although, let me say really, because there is a debate actually in Barcelona, basic income is not a city agenda. I used to work at regional level, forget about it. If you do not want to give like peanuts to citizens, this is a national policy. I'm pretty sure about that, although of course indirect incomes, we can rethink a little bit about the welfare state locally and how we do cheaper services for people that are publicly owned, yes. Then on the scale, just like very quickly, I do think that there still is a meaning when, even if we say re-municipalization of data, that it doesn't mean you're re-municipalizing in the sense you're re-municipalizing energy or other utilities, but what you mean really is a public control over a critical infrastructure that is not only public as state, but also has to involve, I mean, we're actually talking here about data commons, which is a new ownership regime and a new architecture for what the city owns in terms of data, and the city has to be able to use this data to improve policy. It's very basic. And I think it's very clear that lots of this data that make possible for cities to build better services are owned by the citizens, is your data. So there is no way that we do not pose the question of a new deal on data. It has to be there. Then we can talk about the scale of it. We can talk about what kind, of course, to be able to profit from network externalities, you need network infrastructures. Who owns these network infrastructures? So, of course, it's not only a city question. But I think a new pact on data has to be on the agenda, and there is a lot that cities can do there.
Before passing to Paul, I want to introduce an extra element, and the extra element is the increased inequalities. I mean, we are talking here, Barcelona, rich city, very rich city actually in Europe within a frame, institutional frame, but what will happen with the rest of the world? And what will happen with the people in the peripheries where you don't have even access to a toilet, not to say to a computer? And so are we creating this utopia with basic income, with a precarious but still there jobs for some, for the white Westerners, or it is a possibility to have a model for everyone, or we just forget about it and create these increased borders?
I think this is one of the challenges, because just as much as your question, Anna, about the basic income asks about, well, do we have response? Are you going to reintroduce some kind of a contract to it? That's implicit in the fact that it's for citizens. In other words, basic income reintroduces the time value of citizenship. It makes an explicit relationship between tax paying and basic income. One of the biggest problems about it is who should get it. If you set it up, if there was a Barcelona basic income, everybody would move to Barcelona. So, yeah, we're going to have to. This is why I think, you know, it may not be a popular thing to say, but one of the reasons I think that cities are a good unit of experimentation is because you can, you, only so many people can live in a city. You don't need walls as in the Renaissance, but you can basically, it's a controlled population. Now, but let's put this to one side and deal with, I think, what the central question that underlies all of this is, what is the public realm? What do we mean in the 21st century by public? You will know in the 1960s that people tried to understand information as a public good. Economists even now grapple with information as a public good. To me, it's a meaningless concept because the commons, the common good, is the more important and coherent explanation. Here's a worked example of why. The answer to this problem of municipalizing data would be to create an app. So if you are a citizen of the city, then you don't have to, but you can download an app which embodies your citizenship. That's what we should do. Why? Because the easiest way to implement it would be via transport systems. In London, you have to have a card to access the transport system. That gives the privatized transport infrastructure provider knowledge of all your movements. Of course, it would be good if the city has that. What is the average citizen going to say? I'm quite happy for Google to know my movements, but I don't want the person to know my movements who collects my tax. Because the moment they do that, then they know answers to questions like, where do I live? How often do I live in this flat? Am I letting this flat out to Airbnb or subletting my social housing against the law? So the citizen quite correctly mistrusts the public authority when it comes to data. And I think that the democratization, the radical democratization of the state is the only way we're going to be able to recreate trust in a way that allows those citizens to understand that the deal they want to make with the public authority is a deal worth making over data. That's the first thing. I will just say something brief about the question of size. We, probably everybody in this room, has come to conceive the problem of information democracy as being a problem of networks. So who gets the network externalities? Who controls the network? Networks are more powerful than hierarchies. We all believe that. My fear is that artificial intelligence, even at a fairly early stage of its development, will create something that is effectively not a network. That it is implicit in the artificial intelligence model that we go back to non-distributed forms of information. And that the ideal artificial intelligence is not going to be four major monopolies, but one. What's the point of two artificial intelligences unless they just simply play chess against each other? The implicit in the AI concept as a capitalist concept is either one company or, if you really want to be dystopian, one party. You know, that the Orwell's party would have loved AI in a way that they would not like networks. So to finish, I think there is a challenge, however, that says this. People who know more about machine learning than I know say to me that machine learning, which is a low-level form of AI, can do the following. It can take every database, no matter how rubbish, proprietorial, partial, outmoded, extinct. And a machine learning system can take all these inputs and it can work out what the formats for the database was. So it doesn't matter, ultimately, what form the knowledge is held in. Now, if that is true, if that is technically true, I would prefer systems that allow diversity. In other words, you create the machine learning at the center of a system and you allow many, many diverse systems of knowledge formatting and holding. That is, to me, seems to be the it's kind of digital anarchism, and I think it's good. In other words, the machine must process the diverse inputs. The machine must not demand uniformity of input.
I'm sorry, there will not be chance for another round of questions, but I want to close with a reflection. The reflection is something that Evgeny was referring before. Silicon Valley is less and less this private actor detached from governments and detached from politics of a specific government. And so the BITS, the initiative BITS, and what the city of Barcelona is doing is not no longer just challenging this imbalance of power between companies, citizens, and local governments. It's challenging a whole vision of the world and challenging it to be a more democratic one. So let's hope that it succeeds and hope that we can help building it.
I hope that we can help building it. Thank you.